So good evening, everybody. Welcome to this last session of 44th comprehensive course on echocardiography. We have come a long way starting from a beginning to this particular session of constriction versus restriction. And I'll show subsequently a few slides for prosthetic valve for those people who ask for this prosthetic valve so that they can get accustomed to the evaluation of prosthetic valve in their clinical practice. We have with us none other than Dr. S.K. Parashar sir to talk about this constriction versus restrictive pathology. And as he has asked for, like, you can intermittently ask for questions in case you are not able to understand one particular phenomena. You can unmute yourself and at that time you can go ahead and ask the question. So with this few words, let me have the honor of having a talk from Colonel Parashar sir. Sir, it's all yours.
I'll discuss in a very basic manner because number one, don't get frightened that it is a difficult subject. There are only two slides. If those two slides you can understand, there'll be no problem. Now the question always arises that why there is a need for differentiation between the two. One is prognosis. The prognosis is constriction is very good. The patient may be cured after pericardiectomy, or it may be or by some anti-inflammatory drugs. While in restriction, the overall prognosis is poor. Similarly, then the treatment, there is a definite treatment for a constrictive pericarditis, but a very poor treatment for restrictive cardiomyopathy, which may undergo even for a cardiac transplantation. And these are one condition in which there is a multimodality imaging involved, both echo, CT, or MRI. But here, because we are concerned with echo, we'll discuss some basic aspects of echo. Now, why there is a problem in differentiation? Because in many of the cases, there is a similar clinical hemodynamic and some echocardiographic similarities. For example, if there is clinical hemodynamic and echocardiographic similarities, you may be difficult to differentiate between the two unless there is an index of suspicion in your mind. For example, let us say constrictive pericarditis, in which there is a very thick, fibrous, adherent, non-compliant pericardium. And because of a non-compliant pericardium, it does not very well relax or expand. So there's an increased diastolic filling and increased pressure. For example, I will give you a simple example. Suppose you take a new balloon. If you take a new balloon and you try to fill it up, you require more pressure. So that there's a more filling pressure required to fill up that balloon. And when the same balloon becomes older, it is easy to do it. Similarly, when you are filling anything and there is a sort of a problem in filling, you increase the filling pressure. So that means it is you have to increase the pressure to fill the chamber so that there is an increased filling chamber pressure. So in a constrictive pericarditis, it is a very thick pericardium, while in a restrictive cardiomyopathy, it is because of an endomyocardial fibrosis infiltration with the rigid ventricular walls. So why there is a similarity between the two is that because there is a elevation of filling pressure on left side, it can lead to increased pulmonary venous pressure as expected. Then the pulmonary congestion leads to dyspnea and cough. And on the right side, because of an increased right atrial pressure, there increased systemic venous pressure. So raised JVP, edema, feet, ascites, all these findings which may be found in many other situations can be found in these conditions so that you may always miss this. So there may be similarity in echo and the clinical picture. So let us first come to a brief discussion on a constrictive pericarditis, and then we'll go a brief into restrictive cardiomyopathy. Now, so what I have told you that always have a high index of suspicion when there is unexplained dyspnea, you see. There is an unexplained dyspnea and then raised JVP. So when there's the unexplained dyspnea, try to exclude this or heart failure with a normal ejection fraction because this is a very condition associated with a diastolic heart failure. unexplained edema, ascites, raised JVP, as we showed you, that because of increased right-sided pressures, there may be increased edema, ascites or so. Then there are many causes of a constrictive pericarditis, right from idiopathic, but some of the very common ones are tuberculosis, post-cardiac surgery, which is the most common in a Western country, radiation therapy. So if in any of these situations, you get a right heart failure signs, think of a constrictive pericarditis because these are the causes of constrictive pericarditis and causing a right heart failure. Cirrhosis, many other diseases like a restrictive cardiomyopathy, and many skilled diagnostic people can be confused. So the persons always ask, what is a pericardial thickness increase? It is the interpretation is very challenging. In transthoracic echo, it is supposed to be more than 2 millimeters, but very difficult to measure, so it is less reliable. In transesophageal echo, more than 3 millimeters is more sensitive, but a chest CT is very important for finding out the pericardial thickness of calcification, especially 4 millimeters or so. So whenever the diagnosis is in doubt and we want to see the pericardial thickness, we do a chest CT to see for a thickness which should be more than 4 millimeters. So just remember 2, 3, 4. Now remember these two slides, we'll try to make it very simple, but if there's any doubt, you can go on asking. We must demonstrate two fundamental pathological mechanisms to diagnose a constrictive pericarditis. These should be demonstrated either by MOD, by 2D, by any method, MRI or a Doppler. One is known as an exaggerated ventricular interdependence. Now, what is an extra exaggerated ventricular interdependence? As the name indicates, that the one ventricle is always dependent on the other ventricle. What do I mean by this? In a normal pericardium, it regulates the stroke, the volume in both the chambers. That means if there is an increase volume in one chamber, it decreases in other. But in a constrictive pericarditis, there is a fixed cardiac volume because the non-compliant pericardium, non-compliant matlab, it does not agree to anything or so. So for example, if suppose right ventricle and left ventricle both have got 50 ml of blood, suppose the right ventricle gets 60 ml of blood, then left ventricle must get only 40 to maintain a fixed volume of about 100. Similarly, suppose 100 is only just giving an example. Suppose left ventricle gets about 70 ml of blood, then the right ventricle should get about 3 millimeter, 30 ml to manage this fixed cardiac volume. So that means the alteration in volume of one chamber must by necessity is reflected by a change in another chamber. And that is why this is known as a ventricular interdependence, which is exaggerated in these cases because of a fixed pericardial volume. So that, for example, when there is a reduced LV filling, there has to be an increased RV filling. So if there is no doubt about it, that so just remember, basic thing is this, that the volume should always be variable between the two chambers depending upon the interdependence. So if it is reduced in one, it increases in other. So any doubt, you can go on asking because this is one important ventricular interdependence. For example, how when you see this, during inspiration, there's an increased filling of the right ventricle. So when there's increased filling of the right ventricle, the septum is automatically shifted to the left side so that the left ventricular volume becomes less. So this is an interdependence. When the RV volume increases, the LV volume decreases. Now, what happens in expiration? In expiration, the LV volume increases. So when the LV volume increases, so now it pushes the septum on the other side and RV volume decreases. So that an increase in volume in one chamber is compensated by a decrease in volume in other chamber, which is known as a ventricular interdependence. I'll give you a classical example. Just see. Now, this is the right ventricle. Now, this is the inspiration which starts, and this is always an expiration downflow. See, as soon as we are entering the inspiration, the RV increases in size. That means the RV volume increases. You see here, and you see this is RV. As soon as inspiration starts, the RV increases. It pushes the septum back. Just see, it pushes the septum into the left ventricle. So it pushes the septum back. Now, as this is the downslope is expiration. As soon as the expiration starts, the left ventricle increases in size and volume, and the right ventricle decreases. So what we have shown is a classical example, which is not theoretical, but practical. So again, see the RV normal. As soon as inspiration starts, the RV volume increases, pushes septum posteriorly, LV volume decreases. This is known as the ventricular interdependence. Then as soon as the expiration starts, the septum moves toward the right ventricle because the LV volume increases and it becomes less. So this is known as the first clue to diagnosis and is the most sensitive about 93% of cases. The second I told you was a dissociation of intrathoracic and intracardiac pressure with inspiration. Again, don't get scared by this slide, but we'll make it very simple. In a normal individual, during inspiration, the intrathoracic pressure decreases by about 3 to 5 millimeters. Now, the pulmonary vein is not covered by the pericardium. So once this decrease in the pressure, it leads to a similar decrease in the chamber. So there's a decreased flow from pulmonary vein to LA and LV, because ultimately pulmonary vein is the driving force. So if the pressure is maintained, so there's no significant respiratory variation. I'll tell you why. Because there is a uniform filling from the pulmonary vein to the left ventricle. Now what happens in constriction, there is a complete isolation of the heart. It is completely isolated from the body because of a complete calcification and thickening and fibrosis. So there's a decrease in the pulmonary venous pressure as occurs because it is not covered by the pericardium, but all other pressures are increased. So when the LA pressure and everything is increased and the decrease in the PV pressure, so there's a decreased flow from pulmonary vein to LA. Why? Because pulmonary venous pressure decreases, but LA pressure remains high. So the flow is less. So there's a less flow going from pulmonary vein to LA to LV. So there's a decreased LV filling. So when there's a decreased LV filling, there will be an increased RV filling. So when a decreased LV filling occurs, so that means the mitral velocity decreases. A mitral valve or any valve, its opening or restriction depends upon the amount of blood flow from it. So when there is a less blood going into LV, the mitral valve will show a less flow, and this is compensated because of a ventral interdependence. It will show more on the right side. So there is a respiratory variation present. We'll show you just now to clear it more. Now see this. There is inspiration. So in inspiration, there's an increased flow into the right ventricle. So when there's an increased flow into the right ventricle, there will be an increased flow into the right ventricle. From the RA to RV, sorry, from the RA to RV, increased flow. So when there's increased flow from RA to RV, it occurs, then the less flow will go from LA to LV because of an interdependence and shifting of the septum toward the left ventricle. In expiration, what happens? More flow goes into the left side of the heart, and as expected, the LA increases. There's an increased flow through the left ventricle. And again, you see this is compensated by a decreased flow from the RA to RV because the septum shifts toward this side. So to point to note is that during inspiration, there is a less flow into the pulmonary valve, mitral valve, and increased flow toward the tricuspid valve. And in expiration, the reverse occurs. More flow occurs in the mitral valve, and less flow in this. So now we can show you, this is known as a classical respiratory variation. Now see, I've tried to make it as simple as possible. Now what happens? In inspiration, the tricuspid flow increases because of increased filling. And then during expiration, when there is an increased filling of the mitral valve, there is a decreased filling of the tricuspid valve. So the velocity goes on decreasing from inspiration to expiration. From inspiration, you see there is a more flow into the tricuspid valve, so less flow into the mitral valve. And as you see, as the expiration starts, the reverse process occurs, and there is a more velocity of the mitral valve, and there is a decreased velocity of the tricuspid valve because of this respiratory variation and in the interference. So this was a 35-year-old male complaining of cough, dyspnea, swelling of feet, abdomen, vague gastrointestinal symptoms, edema feet, possibly otitis, liver and lungs, and he was referred to gastroenterologist. Many patients have been sent for a liver transplantation when they were found to be a case of constrictive pericarditis. He was investigated for a primary liver disease. During investigation, developed marked tachycardia and was referred to cardiologist. And as you see, the heart rate is about 170. And I'll show you why we suspected a constrictive pericarditis because of this a very jerky motion of RV. But we'll show you as if there is a jerky motion as compared to other things also. But the diagnostic feature was the same, which is the first echo sign of constrictive pericarditis. And you see heart rate is still 169. And the same classical ventricular interdependence which gave us a diagnosis of a constrictive pericarditis. Luckily, parasternal long axis view is the first view you always take in these cases. Now, there are many other reasons for development of a diagnosis of constrictive pericarditis, but we'll go, some of them are Doppler-based, we'll be subsequently show you later, but two things one we see. Now, this is known as a shudder of the interventricular septum. Why it happens? Because during inspiration, there is a more filling of the right ventricle, so the septum moves this side. During expiration, the reverse occurs. So with a large number of cardiac cycles, this inward and outward motion produces a carotid shudder, a septal shudder, like a jerky motion. And this is because of a differential flow between the right and left ventricle as related to this. So whenever we see this, it always gives us a doubt. In this case, patient, there was no problem because there's already marked thickening of the pericardium, but just to tell you how it looks like. So when you see a short axis with another patient, you see there is a shudder or a jerky motion of this thing. So this should give you a suspicion, not that it gives you a 100% diagnosis, but this should give you a suspicion that yes, look for some signs of this. And I will tell you now, the first sign we always look for is a IVC in these cases. So you see, this is the shudder. Then you see there is an IVC dilated. Why? Why it is dilated is because there is an increase in the right atrial pressure. And as I told you in the first slide, that any chamber subjected to increased pressure or volume increases in size. So once the IVC is subjected to increased pressure, which is in the right atrium, it enlarges in size. So suppose the first thing is absence of IVC change without diuresis questions the diagnosis. So if I suspect constrictive pericarditis, I straight away go to the IVC. If the IVC is not enlarged or it collapses, we ask the patient, is he getting diuretic or so? Suppose he says, no, he's not been given any diuretic or anything. So that gives us the diagnosis to whether it is excluded or included. So this is a very important sign of a dilated, forget about plethoric, a dilated IVC in absence of a diuresis is a very important sign of a constrictive pericarditis and also restrictive. So So there are five principal signs of constrictive pericarditis. One we have already told you, a respiratory related, there's a ventricular septal motion that is an exaggerated ventricular interdependence. Then this variation in mitral E velocity, as I told you, because here, when there is a decreased LV filling, the mitral velocity will be decreased. Then there will be increased velocity filling, the tricuspid velocity will be increased. So you see here, this we have already shown you, and this you must keep in mind, how the inspiration mitral wall will decrease, and in expiration, this tricuspid wall will decrease. Now you see this patient. Remember, whenever you're seeing a mitral wall, you reduce your speed so that more of the complexes are seen. Now this is inspiration, this is expiration. You see, at the first beat during inspiration, the velocity is only about 68 centimeters per second. And the first beat after expiration, the velocity is about 99 or 100. So the formula is E expiration minus E inspiration divided by E expiration into 100 gives you the respiratory variation. And in this case, it was about 30%, when normally it should not be more than 10 to 12 or 12 to 10 to 14%. You take any complex. Here you take, this is inspiration, very small velocity, and during expiration, it increases. The same what I have shown you, the various diagrammatic representation. So this is known as the respiratory variation, though it can be found in many of the situations, but when it is found, when you are finding other signs of a constrictive pericarditis, it is a good sign, and you see variation in this, and this is the formula, expiration minus inspiration, then E expiration. Remember, it should be the first beat during inspiration and the first beat during expiration. This is expiration, like this everywhere. And the same thing, you see, during expiration, what will happen? The mitral will increase. And during inspiration, the tricuspid will increase. In inspiration, you saw the mitral wall decreasing. And here you see, this is inspiration. This is the velocity, and this is expiration significantly decreased. So this is inspiration, this is expiration. So the respiratory variation more than about 40%. So what we have shown you is not theory, but actual practical. Now, sometimes remember, a very difficult question comes that, suppose you don't have a respirometer, then what you do? Remember, one basic dictum is, when you are recording a lot of mitral Doppler, then the one we show the lowest velocity is during inspiration. Forget about a respirometer also. So the lowest velocity is always during inspiration, and then you can see will be inspiration or expiration. So this is the same formula during atrial fibrillation also. The lowest velocity is always during inspiration when you are seeing the mitral. And this is again, you see, the lowest in expiration is the tricuspid flow. So this is the second sign. Now I won't go too much at this, because I'm told that you have only been told tedious. Remember what happens, a tissue Doppler, as you have been told, record the longitudinal velocity across the annulus, the mitral and the tricuspid annulus. The more the longitudinal velocity movement, the greater will be the annulus. So in a constrictive pericarditis, you see, there's a more of a filling in the early diastole before the LV stops suddenly expanded because of the constriction. So when there is an exaggerated longitudinal motion, so tissue Doppler, which records the longitudinal motion of the annulus, will be increased. Now you see, this is a medial annulus. We have put a tissue Doppler here, and you see the early diastolic velocity is about 13 centimeters per second. Then when you put on the medial lateral side, it's about 17. So this shows us two things. This is a normal patient. So this shows us two things, that the lateral velocities are always more than the medial velocity. So that is remembered, because here we are, this is the ventricle, so we are taking a longitudinal motion, and this is longitudinal motion. So this is systole, this is early diastole, and this is late diastole. So this is the normal velocity. It should be more than 9 in these cases. And here it is this, and the lateral velocity is more. So there is another condition known as the in constrictive pericarditis, known as annulus reversus. That means there is a reversus of the process. Now here you see the median annulus is 18 centimeters, but the lateral is about 12 centimeters. This is the reverse of what we have seen just now. You see, this is the reverse of what we have seen just now, and hence it is known as the annulus reversus, and there are reasons why the lateral velocities are decreased also. So this is another important sign. The annulus reversus was about 1.5:1, and normally should be about 0.98 or so. So here you see, so it is 12 and this is 18, so it is 1.5:1. So this is known as the annulus reversus, highly specific sign. Now the same patient after surgery, you see, this remains 18, but this has increased to about 13 to 14. So this becomes 1.1:1. So that after surgery, the annulus reversus becomes less. So this is the, these are the few signs also, and we don't want you to get confused with hepatic vein, but you see, this is the systolic velocity, diastolic, and a very small expiratory reversal. But here you see there is a significantly increased expiratory reversal in these cases also. So finally, coming to this, three things are most important. One, now you see, they have given less importance to the mitral E velocity, because this can be found in various other situations also, many other situations. So they have given an example of one ventricular separation effect, medial velocity, and hepatic vein. They are one of the most important signs of this constrictive pericarditis with a significantly increased diagnostic parameter. So always practice the ventricular septal defect and let it be a normal respiration. Don't force the patient to take respiration. And that is why I say every time you do an echo, always try to record an hepatic vein, which may sometime be of value to you. Now, coming to the restrictive cardiomyopathy, now there are various types of this. We see a lot of idiopathy, Loeffler, that is the eosinophilic, EMF, amyloidosis also. These are some of the restrictive cardiomyopathies. So because they restrict the heart, and post-radiation is important, the diagnosis is based on 2D echo and Doppler findings, because an advanced echo find diagnosis is done by the MRI. MRI is a good test for restrictive cardiomyopathy, and previously they used to do the a myocardial biopsy also to conclude this diagnosis. But then they found that during biopsy, that particular portion may not be having restrictive cardiomyopathy. So it is mainly at our level, between your level is this. One is a normal size ventricles with normal functional until late stage. And IVS thickening may be there, pericardial effusion may be there. For example, here you see, I think it was moving in the morning. So you see, the IVS may be thickened or not, but and there may be a small pericardial effusion, and you see the right ventricle and the left ventricle are of a normal size. They are of a normal size also, as you see in this patient also, and the function appears to be normal. But on this finding, you cannot say that it is a restrictive cardiomyopathy. Second is a biatrial overload present. A biatrial because of an increased pressure of the chambers. Now, this is a very classical thing. you see a normal size right ventricle, a normal size left ventricle contracting normally with a massive dilatation of the atria. This is because of an increased pressure in the chamber so that this. So whenever we see this picture, we always keep a possibility of a restriction in this in our mind, because this is a very classical finding. Normal size ventricles, normally functioning ventricles, and the presence of a significant RA and LA enlargement. So these 2D findings are very important. Then there may be MR or TR.
Sir, we have to see the mitral regurgitation or tricuspid regurgitation in this film, sir. Because if MR or TR is present, then restrictive cardiomyopathy is ruled out, sir.
Why?
Because of...
See, the MR and TR may be present in these cases because the same restrictive process of can involve the mitral and the tricuspid wall. So this is a proved case, and here you see that there is a mitral and tricuspid regurgitation. You see a mitral regurgitation and you see a tricuspid regurgitation. This can also cause the dilatation. I'll come to it again. And again, you see mild to moderate TH. This is not so important or so. Previously, we used to say that if it is more than 50, it favors a constrictive. If it is less than 50, it favors a restrictive. But this is just to show that there is some increase in the velocity. Then the most important is a dilated IVC. And here you see same patient, you see a IVC is dilated and shows a decreased systolic thickening. So you see the same RA is significantly enlarged, IVC is enlarged and shows a decreased systolic thickening. So that this patient had a normal RV function, normal LV function, normal LA size, a RV size, normal LA size, LV size, a mild thickening of the septum, a minimal pericardial effusion, a significant biatrial overload, and the presence of a IVC changes. You see here also, there is a 14 and 26, respiratory variation is present less than 50% or so. So this is just to show out of. And now the Doppler report. So 2D echo findings, especially I would say a parasternal long axis or an apical or if you have to choose between the two, apical four chamber view is a sort of a good diagnostic criteria. And then of course, subcostal view, you have to see the IVC. That is the thing. Now, Doppler finding, you see, they have been taught to you that there is a sort of a restrictive phenomena in which there is a tall E wave, small A wave, and the ratio is about 3.07. Now, because I don't know whether you have been taught about a diastolic function or not, but this is a restrictive picture. The same, all these findings, never believe on one particular finding. They always combine all these findings, and this increased E wave is because of an increased LA pressure. The more the mean LA pressure increase, more is the E wave. And then because this is a myocardial disease, this one, and because most of the filling has occurred in E wave, the more less occurs in the A wave, so the EA ratio becomes significantly increased. Now, this is again to show you how a Doppler looks like. This is a systolic wave, which comes in with the systole, and this is an early diastolic wave, what is known as E prime, and this is the atrial, what we have been showing previously. Now, here what happened, you see, there is a significantly decreased systolic wave because it is a myocardial disease. It is a myocardial disease, and any myocardial disease leads to a decrease in the systolic velocity and also a significant decrease in the diastolic velocity, because it is also a one of the diastolic abnormalities seen in these cases also. But for example, you see, take myocardial infarction, cardiomyopathy, the E wave will be significantly increased. And one of the criteria put by one of the workers from USA was, but then it, he made it 8, then the person made it 6, that he found that in a cases that was long time back, that in constrictive pericarditis, the E prime VA was more than 8, but in a restrictive cardiomyopathy, it was less than 8. Then it came to 6 also, but the point to note is that this, you have seen that all the tissue Doppler velocities are markedly increased in these cases, except here. And you see that TR, that we have already jet velocity also. Now you see the patient, now you see a massive LVH present. Now this patient is not, as I said you, that in a late stage, there may be a dysfunction. So you see this, once you come to the apical view, you see the LVRV function reduced, their size is normal, but you see there is a significant biatrial enlargement. So there is a biatrial enlargement here, but you see the functions have been reduced, and so that is an advanced stage, possibly of amyloidosis also. And you see in this patient, you see the E or E prime ratio, which you see is about 20:1, when it should be less than 10:1 or so. The E velocity was about 62 centimeters per second. This is E. And this E prime was much, much less. The value would be written there was about 3 or 4 centimeters or so. And you see the ratio was 20:1, indicative of a significant diastolic dysfunction. So this is because of a late stage of these. So these are some less important findings in a 2D echo, a jerky and a shudder IVS motion, which is not seen in the restriction. There is apparently no cardiac hypertrophy. Question mark we have written. Here there is a dilated atria. The thickened pericardia may not be seen, unless you do a CT or an MRI also. But here there is a normal pericardium. IVC is enlarged in both of them. Now, in a constriction, what I was saying, that the MRTR may be no, or it may be mild. It may be no, but may be mild, but here it is present. This is less important now. Mitral Doppler, more than 25 to 30% respiratory variation, which is not seen in this restrictive physiology. TDI, you see more than 8 centimeters, less than 8 centimeters or so. So that the main thing is using this Doppler and the 2D echo, you can diagnose the restriction. And this is a difficult slide, one slide just to show that how much cardiac MRI and cardiac CT. Now this is echo. You see the mitral E dash velocity is increased because of an excessive longitudinal motion. If it is increased, it favors constriction. If it is decreased, it favors restriction. Because of the myocardial disease, the overall motion of the annulus is decreased. Medial E dash to the lateral dash velocity, that was known as annulus reversus, favors constriction. If it is decreased, it favors restriction. So these are more of these things also. Transmitral flow, in case there is an increased respiratory variation, it favors constriction, but if there is no such variation, it is favors restriction. The septal shift, what we have seen there, is usually more favor of a constriction. So that many of these Doppler features, and they are the other features which are hepatic vein, their features also. But at your level, possibly this may be slightly more helpful. But if you see it, so that means you should always present with a CA, mitral Doppler, a tissue Doppler, a hepatic vein in all cases, and then you can get differentiate between the two. So any questions or anything? Because I've tried to make it very brief and very simple. You see any international or national conference, there is always a talk on differentiation between restriction and constriction. There are many other things that come. and strain imaging and many other things will come. But here we have drawn before you only those things which you can do.
Thank you, sir. Any questions from the delegates to ask for constriction from restriction cardiomyopathy? Okay, let's talk a little bit about this assessment of normal and dysfunctional prostatic valve. That's what the topic today is. If you look at these valves, how do I present these valves? I say this is a man-made contraception implanted in the heart. Like this is a kind of a device which controls the blood flow across the various chambers of the heart, which has been devised by a man. And this is implanted in a patient who has got a diseased either aortic or mitral valve or tricuspid pulmonic valves. This is a picture of fluoroscopy, which we often see in our lab when we are looking at these prostatic valves. And why do we look for these pictures is, if you happen to look at this picture very carefully, the two discs can be seen with this device. So we look at both aortic flow and confirm subsequently either we have a CT or a fluoroscopic image to confirm our findings. So most important thing when we look at a prostatic valve evaluation is we need to look what are the symptoms with which the patient is presenting, what is the date of replacement, what is the type and the size of prostatic valve, what is the heart rate, what is the blood pressure of a patient. So this is what we exactly look before we're doing an evaluation. Then image the valve from multiple scan planes to look for in thrombus or pannus. Evaluate cardiac chamber size and function, full Doppler study including PA pressures, presence and location and severity of any regurgitation if it's present. And when we're looking for regurgitation, we have to look whether the regurgitation is coming from inside the valve or outside the valve. Then comparison with the baseline echo or the last echo which is available. This is what I always say when I talk of this particular topic. We have to have a previous echo image. And in our setup, whenever we discharge a person with the MVR or AVR, we always do a pre-operative echo, post-operative echo at least 3 to 6 weeks differently, or maybe at the time of a discharge from the hospital. So if you look at a prostatic heart wall, they are a foreign body to the heart. They are intrinsically stenotic and leaking. It's only the degree that decides whether they are normal functioning or abnormal functionings. That's what it means by. Next is these questions. Let me elaborate in detail. What we ask when the patient comes, when operated, operation notes, immediate post-operative echo, routine checkup. Subsequently, we advise for every 1 year, presenting with a fever, breathlessness, embolic episode, mode of onset of symptoms, and history of taking anticoagulants regularly or irregularly. And what are the valves which we look for? We look for valves which are biological. Biological could be stented versus non-stented or stentless or a mechanical valves. Then in valves, we have three parts of a particular valve. One is a sewing ring. Second is a housing structure. Third is an occluder. If I have to show you a particular valve over here, this is a valve which has got three parts. This is known as ball and cage valve. This is a housing structure. These studs are housing structure. This is an occluder, which is ball is an occluder. And this ring is a sewing ring with which it is sutured to the annulus of the valve, whether aortic or mitral valve. On the other hand, we have this biological and this is mechanical. Mechanical could be bileaflet, single tilting disc device, or a caged valve. This is an example of ball and cage valve. So in this ball and cage valve, when we look at an echo, we see this is an annulus where you see a sewing rings, and this is an occluder, which is seen a large murky wall. And here is a ball which occludes a flow. So this is ball and cage valve, which we often see in our practice in day-to-day circumstances. On the second is we have single tilting this device. So this is a sewing ring, or in word is sewing ring. If we can say Indian language, English language is sewing ring. This is a housing and this is an occluder. Similarly, we have a bileaflet disc. Here is the sewing ring. This is an housing structure and these are the two discs which occludes it. If you look from a previous disc, you see a single line of reverberations. This is a reverberation from the annulus or a housing structure or a sewing ring, because this sewing ring is also made of metal. So we have this reverberations on both sides and this is a reverberation of a disc. On the contrary, if you look at bileaflet disc, this is a two reverberations arising from these two bileaflet discs. So this is a reverberation from a disc. This is a reverberations from the sewing ring, which is again made of metal. And when we look at a color flow, we'll find at least 2 to 3 jets arising from these bileaflet jets. One jet arising from this, second from this, and the third from this. And this is seen 3 jets arising from this bileaflet mechanical valve. And when we look at an evaluation, we try to evaluate from the lateral or the peripheral jets rather than a central jet, because central jet would be a stenotic jet. Now comes bioprosthetic valve. If you look at these bioprosthetic valve, the leaflets are made of a porcine or a bovine tissue. They have a housing structures of this porcine and bovine tissue. They do not have any occluder. Then this could be made of metal or without a metal. If it's made of metal, then is known as stents. If it is not made of metal, this is known as stentless bioprosthetic valves. These are inserted at mitral or aortic or tricuspid positions. In newer generation biological valves, what we have been using in tower today is the core valve or a Edwards Sapien valve, which are the self-expanding valve. So we are not going to talk much about this Edwards and core valves during this prosthetic valve evaluations. So in biological valve, we can have a porcine, xenograft, pericardial xenograft, homograft, and autograft. In mechanicals, we can have a bileaflet, caged valve, or single tilting disc device. Where do we fit them? Majority of these valves, they are fit in either mitral or in aortic positions when we talk of mechanical valves. And when we talk of a bioprosthetic valves, they are majority of time put in a tricuspid positions because of the low pressure chambers on the right hand side. So they are acoustically dense because of metallic structure, so they emit differently. They are intrinsically stenotic and regurgitant, so then you have to know their normal values, especially postoperatively. Think of effective orifice area, not the valve area. When we look at this evaluation, we always talk of a valve area as effective orifice area, though the method of calculation remains the same. Understand the valve body mismatch. Then when we look at an assessment, we look at an assessment of rings and a disc motion, forward and regurgitant flow, driving peak and mean gradients, effective orifice area, something like continuity equation and pressure half time, which is reliable, assess mismatch and decide normal or abnormal. So my request to all my colleagues is please take a good Doppler parameters before you discharging a patient from a hospital with a post-operative replacement valves, so that subsequently they can be easily followed if they have a small deteriorations. Now question comes, how do we quantitate all these kind of a things? Quantitation is, I said, clinical evaluations. Then echo evaluation is something same like a native valve evaluations. And whatever we are going to talk about, we are going to talk about our guidelines made by American Society of Echo in 2009 as well as 2014 as well. So this is all parameter which we utilize in our lab as on today. we always look at a clinical history, date, type, and size of the valve replacement. We take a patient height, weight, body surface area, heart rate, and blood pressure as of now, symptoms and related clinical finding. Then imaging of the valve happens with the motion of leaflet and occluder, calcium and other echo density of the valve components, valve sewing ring and its integrity, Doppler informations, other echocardiographic data like LV function and other sizes, and compare with post-operative studies when available. And we call it should be available if somebody has got a good surgical setup where he's got his valve done. In Dopplers, what do we evaluate? We evaluate peak velocity, mean gradient, velocity time integral of prosthetic mitral valve versus LVOT, effective orifice area, and a pressure half time. Let's look one by one. Other parameters, LVRV size and functions, LARA size, concomitant valvular disease, estimation of PA pressure. If you look at carefully, practically it works like evaluating the same patients when we are evaluating a prosthetic valve. Only fact is we are looking at LVOT VTI, despite the fact we are looking at the mitral valve. So let's look one by one. So here I'm trying to show you a picture of a plaques view. Here's aorta, here's the mitral valve. And if you put on the colors, you see an aortic regurgitation which is happening, which is mild aortic regurgitation. If you carefully concentrate on this, you have this annulus which appears to be like hyperechoic, and you have a leaflet in between. So at this present moment, it appears to be a prosthetic mitral valve. But what kind of a thing? We have to go further to look at the prosthetic mitral valve. Now, when we look at this prosthetic mitral valve, when the valve is closing, when the valve is opening. Now, when the valve is opening, you can see these two disc signs or reverberations which are seen over here. Same reverberation, they're seen in four chamber as well as two chamber size. And you can see these reverberations, one over here, second over here, one over here, second over here. So this is metallic bileaflet prosthetic valve, which is seen over here. We do not see anything on a ventricular side, pannus or thrombus. Similarly, we cannot see anything on the LA size because there's a lot of reverberations which are seen. When we switch on the colors, this is the three chamber view. When we switch on the colors, we try to see three jets arising from here. One, two, and three. I'll try to hold for you and to assess. You can see a three jets which is arising from three different orifices which are seen in bileaflet valves. So this is to show it very categorically, three-dimensional picture with bileaflet valves. And when they're closed, they'll give you complete reverberations as if you do not know whether single or double tilting this device. Now, same picture in three dimensions. Again, three dimensions for three chamber view. And this is how we start looking for any pannus which is present on the ventricular side. And most important thing is you can see the two discs when they're closing and opening, suggesting that the valve is appearing, functioning normally. When we put in a Doppler flow across this mitral valve, what do you see? You see a mitral flow across this valve. But the most important thing, what else you see? You see this line over here. You see this line over here. This is mitral valve opening click, mitral valve closing click, because this is metallic in structure. Important thing is, before you record this mitral valve opening, the mitral flow has already started in this particular patient, suggesting that the mitral valve leaflets are almost, or prosthetic mitral valve is almost normal. And when we look at this kind of a flow by continuous wave Doppler or pulse wave Doppler, we do a planimetry of this particular Doppler flow patterns. And we did a planimetry of this Doppler flow pattern. It shows a peak velocity of 1.43 and a mean gradient of 8.2 in this particular patient with a VTI of across mitral valve is 41.5 centimeters. Zoomed up pictures, 69 heart rate, 41.5, 1.43 and 8.2, sorry, 3.9 is a mean gradients when we try to calculate it or show it in a larger. Many people would ask you whether we should start from there or we should start from here. We have to measure the mitral flow pattern, not the looking at the opening or closing click in the subset of populations. When we put this parameter across the prosthetic mitral valve evaluation, what we are needing with? We need the peak velocity. My peak velocity was less than 1.9. Mean gradient was 3.4. Then we have to have a pressure half time, effective orifice area, and then VTI across prosthetic valve oblique LVOT. So to look at all this, we calculate the same from a pressure half time. We can draw a line, it's 2.2 or 100 milliseconds is the pressure half time. Then the VTI is over here. We can look at the LVOT VTI and calculate the functioning of this prosthetic metallic bileaflet mitral valve. Then come bioprosthetic. Now look at this bioprosthetic mitral valve. This is stents, which are their housing, which is present over here. Then these are the leaflet, and look at the laminar flow, which you can see over here. The red flow is a laminar flow, which is seen over here. And when we put a Doppler flow pattern across all these laminar flows, here is a three-dimensional picture. We hardly see any leaflets. And when we do a Doppler flow pattern across this, we see our velocity is 2.21 meters per second. Mean gradient is 7.1. And a pressure half time of 393. That was normal angio patient. Now this is definitely increased more than 1.9, more than 4, and this the pressure half time is more than 100 milliseconds. So this is how we look at those two patterns in mitral, aortic, and bioprosthetic mitral valve evaluations. Then come next. Prosthetic aortic valve evaluations, again, the things remain the same. Peak velocity, mean gradient. Now we calculate Doppler velocity integral, effective orifice area, then exhalation time and a contour of jet across this aortic valve. What is DVI, Doppler velocity index? Doppler velocity index is nothing but a ratio of velocity at LVOT versus velocity of the jet of the prosthetic valve. Here the velocity across LVOT is 1.1 meters per second and the velocity across prosthetic valve is 2.8 meters per second. So 1.1 divided by 2.8, it gives you a 0.4 of a velocity, Doppler velocity index or DVI. So effective orifice area is whatever the continuity equation is, the same continuity equation applies over here. But we don't call them as aortic valve area. We say effective orifice area. This is LVOT diameter. And this LVOT diameter would be a little smaller than the diameter of native LVOT because this valve is implanted already in this particular patient. So we have a cross-sectional area across LVOT. That's pi r square is an cross-sectional area across LVOT. Then we have LVOT VTI. And multiply these two factors and divide by velocity time integral of the continuous wave Doppler of the prosthetic valve, we'll get an effective orifice area. Then look for acceleration time. How much time does it take to accelerate or peaking happens or the peak of the flow happens in prosthetic valve? When we look at this kind of phenomena, so this is known as acceleration time. Here is an aortic valve processes. It appears to be metallic. We see a lot of vibration, reverberations seen over here. No significant turbulence or jet is seen. We look at an LV size, which looks to be reasonably normal. Then we look at aortic valve flow across this prosthetic valve, 2.69. Mean gradient is 13.5. And then we have velocity time integral of 53.2. At the same time, we look at a pulmonary aortic valve exhalation time, which is 78 milliseconds. This is beginning, and the peak of this exhalation time is 78 milliseconds. So zoomed up picture, 2.57, 11.6, 47.8. These are three parameters which are going to utilize. Then these parameters, then LV functions, four chamber, three chamber, and then in three dimensions, we look at an LV functions. And put up these parameters in presence of aortic valve prosthesis. So peak velocity, normal, possible stenosis, definite stenosis. So normal is less than 3 to 2.69. The mean gradient less than 20 is 14. Exhalation time is less than 78. Less than 80, this is 78. So if we put up these parameters across this, we get a aortic valve evaluation. At the same time, we can look at a Doppler flow velocity in DVI. So how do we look for a DVI? We have two parameters, and this is not shown, like aortic valve VTI, and then we have LVOT VTI. The Doppler flow, Doppler velocity index will give us a DVI in this particular subject. Next comes assessment of prosthetic tricuspid valve. Again, you look at it, peak velocity, mean gradient, pressure half time, the effective orifice area, and prosthetic valve VTI divided by LVOT. There's no data available on this. Majority of time, what we look is a peak velocity and a mean gradient and a pressure half time in tricuspid valves. So that's how we put a sample volume across this normal prosthetic valve. That gives you a Doppler flow pattern. And with this Doppler flow pattern, we look at a peak velocity, mean gradient, and the pressure half time to assess their severity. Here is the example for bioprosthetic tricuspid valve from our own lab. So look at the very good laminar flow in this particular patient who had been implanted with tricuspid valve over here. This is seen in three dimensions. And then we look at a peak velocity, then we look for a mean gradient and a pressure half time in this particular patient of prosthetic valve. And when we put up these parameters across the findings of the normal size, look at the velocity was only 1.62 and the mean gradient was 6.3. So 1.62 is normal, mean gradient is close to 6, and the pressure half time is only 140 milliseconds. So there's mild variability from the parameters which we see. But when we look at these kind of mild variability, we do not put much emphasis on this. We say almost normal prosthetic tricuspid prosthetic valve. Last, prosthetic pulmonic valve. We look at this prosthetic pulmonic valve by looking at the same kind of a parameters of peak velocity, mean gradient, Doppler velocity index, and effective orifice area in prosthetic pulmonic valves. Now, a couple of examples from abnormalities. One is thrombus, second is vegetation, third is pannus, tissue prosthetic degeneration, mechanical problem like stuck wall, problem of in situ native valves, and then mismatch dysfunctions. Look at this valve which has been explanted. Look at this pannus which is almost occupied the half of this orifice of the valve which is seen over here. And when this kind of a phenomena happens, another picture from this ball and cage valve, look, huge thrombus formation on this particular valve. So pannus versus thrombus, which is very, very important thing. And it's very difficult to differentiate between pannus versus thrombosis. Acute onset, always thrombosis, but could be pannus. So this is one picture from a journal of thoracic disease. More than 12 months of after surgery, chances of pannus is very high. Thrombus could be at any time. Location below prosthesis at any point. Circular mass extending the sewing ring. It could be irregular lobulated mass. Then this is what is the most important part which has learned over a period of time. CT can really differentiate what is this thrombus or pannus is. Pannus has got a more than 145 attenuation value by CT, which is less than 145, which favors thrombus. And this Hounsfield units has found to be very useful parameters to differentiate between thrombus and pannus when we are talking of patients, when we have a doubt whether it is thrombus or pannus. Now look at these slides one by one. 32-year-old female presenting with breathlessness, sudden onset for 2 to 3 days. No history of cough, cold expectation. Mitral valve replacement was done. She was 24 years of age. Vital parameters showed features of congestive cardiac failure with low blood pressure and tachycardia. Nothing significant. Now look at this picture seen over here, and I'll try to show you a June picture of the same subject. Now see a June picture of the same subject. She had a bileaflet disc. So you can see which is a large flow which is happening from this and a smaller flow happening from this. And I do not know whether at this point this is single or tilted, double tilting this device, because I could not see any reverberations behind. I did not have any history at that time. But we put a Doppler flow pattern across this envelope. What we get a peak velocity of 2.87 and a mean gradient of almost 22 millimeters of mercury. And heart rate of 80 and a velocity time integral of 104 centimeters, what is seen over here. A definite case of a stuck prostatic valve. Aortic flow velocity was reasonably normal. And then we look at a pressure half time across this prostatic valve. It was 162, 177, 173. And then LVOT diameter, 1.8 centimeters. And again, zoomed up picture of 3.27, 24.2, mean gradient, 92.7. Look at the little variability when we do it again and again. And when we put up these findings across the finding of the prostatic valve is peak velocity, that was 1.9, is 2.87. More than 6 is 24. Pressure half time less than 100 is 170. Velocity time integral of prostatic heart valve versus LVOT, this is 3.5. Effective orifice area is only 0.71. And raised PA pressure of 49 millimeters of mercury. So this is what the patient is having at this particular moment when we talk of the prostatic valve over here, 1.9, 5, 2, and 130 milliseconds, suggesting that this is a stuck prostatic valve. So when we had this stuck prostatic valve, we do a thrombolysis and or we can do a replacement of the valve to get rid of them from the obstructions, and that's how we look at these cases subsequently. Now, this is one picture of a valve, which is classically a bileaflet valve. Now, look at this bileaflet valve very carefully. Two reverberations seen over here. This is a sewing ring, one on this side, one on this side. Look at something which is moving over here. Can you see something moving over here? This is transesophageal echo picture. Something moving over here, you can see it's seen over here also. And there's some tissue which is moving over here. This is thrombus versus vegetation in a patient who had a bileaflet mitral valve processes being done. And most important part is, look at the leakage which is happening. Look, this is a sewing ring and this leakage is happening from outside the sewing ring from a paravalvular leak. And this is what the paravalvular leak is in this patient. When we see this picture and we are categorically showing that the leak is happening from a paravalvular side. Presence of possibly vegetations, one, two, and a presence of significant paravalvular leak, suggesting that this prostatic valve has got this kind of a phenomenon. Now, important thing is, what do you do? Majority of time, these paravalvular leak, they need to be replacements. But we can do sometime with the M-PLAS device closer to close this prostatic valve by doing a 3-dimensional echo and then closing them completely. Next comes aortic valve. Look, this is a presentation of another aortic valve with a lot of pannus or thrombus seen over here. Here is a patient of 56-year-old male with a previous history of AVR 6 years back, presented to OPD with a gradually increasing breathlessness. Nothing significant. BP was normal, ST segment depression, Pfizer LVH. And then we did an echocardiography of this patient. Look, very good contracting LV. And here's a prostatic aortic valve in situations. We try to measure the LVOT diameter, which number of times becomes very difficult because we cannot measure it properly. But once we look at a Doppler flow pattern across the aortic valve, look at the gradient across the aortic valve. 4.79, mean is 3.55, peak gradient 91 and a mean gradient of 56 millimeters of mercury. Almost a severe aortic stenosis or prostatic valve stenosis, which is seen in this patient. And we now measure the LVOT diameter. And then again, an exhalation time from this patient. And again, measuring of this aortic valve gradients. And once we put up all these for effective orifice area is 3.14, 2.1 was a LVOT diameter divided by 2 and square it up into 18, that LVOT diameter, LVOT VTI is 18.5. And then divide by aortic valve VTI is 99 and give you a value of 0.62 as an effective orifice area. Same continuity equation. Only thing is when we call this, we call them as effective orifice area. So LVOT dia, LVOT VTI, aortic valve VTI, peak velocity, mean gradient, exhalation time, and effective orifice area is 0.62. All these things, they categorically suggest that possibly we are dealing with significant stenosis matching up with this kind of a pattern, which is seen over here. I'm sorry, I do not have any picture of prostatic aortic regurgitations with me, so I can't show you that, but it is one the same thing. When you have a paraprostatic leak, you can have these kind of features. Before I move to another thing, that is prostatic tricuspid valve dysfunctions, one thing I would like to say, whenever these valves are implanted, they have some amount of valvular leak, because that trivial leak would always be seen number of times, and never think that those leaks are significant. If you have a prostatic tricuspid valve stenosis or dysfunction, this is how we look at these tricuspid stenosis. We look at the same peak velocity, mean gradient, and a pressure half time to assess for tricuspid valve stenosis. I hope the slide should, no, it's not playing. Then we have tricuspid valve regurgitations. Again, the same thing presenting with these patients with a prosthetic tricuspid regurgitation, then pulmonic valve dysfunction and pulmonic valve regurgitations. Unfortunately, none of this picture is with me right now. Now the question comes, how do we manage these valves? That is the most important thing to manage these valves is. We have to have them anticoagulated if they are prosthetic valves, mechanical valves, and the anticoagulation is we do with warfarin along with aspirin, 75 milligrams per day. To maintain the INR of 2.5 to 3, that is significant what we manage all the time. Many people, they say 3, and what we talk of 3 to 3.5 in majority of these people, when we talk of, but range what we measure and try to keep in our country is 2.5 to 3 as a maintained INR. If you are sensitive to aspirin, you can use clopidogrel, but the drug of choice is aspirin along with anticoagulants. Apart from this maintenance issue, what not to eat, that is the most important thing. What we have is an important issue. So let me just close down slide and then get back to what not to eat is, because this is one important thing which is very, very important in our country. And majority of time, we do not put emphasis on these things, what not to be eaten by our patients. I have got a slides and a depiction of what not to eat. I like to share with you, because majority of patients, what comes back to us, they do not know what to eat, what not to eat. And when we look at these people, what not to eat is, they are eating what is not advised to eat. So I'm going to show you that prescription or that particular phenomena by sharing my slides on what not to eat. So I hope you can see my slides. So on one side, we are giving them vitamin K anticoagulants. Then on the other side, we are using vitamin K. So what not to eat is herbs, which is dried basils, like I say, like any leafy vegetables containing of dhania, pudina, whatever it is, we are not advised to eat these kind of a things. And this is fresh parsley, dried coriander, dried parsley, dried marjoram, basil, fresh chives. So whatever like green herbs which we have in our food habits, we do not use them. Green leafy vegetables, especially the spinach and mustard greens or a khale, we do not advise them to eat. They should not eat these kind of a things when they are having their things in our kitchen, in their kitchens. Then spring onions or a salad vegetables, they should avoid these spring onions or salad vegetables. Next comes the band gobi or a brassica vegetables. And this kind of a cabbage or a frozen broccoli or Chinese broccoli or a green broccoli, this is always advisable not to eat these kind of a things. They help, they interfere with anticoagulants. Another important thing is chili powders and hot spices, which could be a curry powder, paprika, or black pepper, which we use in day-to-day practice in our kitchens, should not be eaten by these subjects. Then comes the most important thing, which we never understand, and it patients often eat, is the okra or a bhindi, what we call in our country. So frozen asparagus, we hardly eat. The cooked leeks, we hardly eat. But the cooked okra, which we eat a lot in our country, we should try to eat the avoid these kind of a substance in our food as on today. Then comes next is a cucumber. Another important thing not to be eaten with these people who are having these anticoagulants. Then soya bean, cooked vegetables. Then comes olive oil. And last comes the dried fruit or prunes, like blueberries, pears, peaches, figs, and currants. They should be advised not to eat these kind of a thing in their clinical, in their life, because they interfere with vitamin K antagonists, which are using in day-to-day practice for their food habits. So with this, let me stop it over here and take up your questions of whatever the things you have in mind. I'm sure